Hello and welcome once again to Friday Night Frights. As always, I'm your host, Peter Yakovetsky. We were not on the air last week because of the college radio day, but that was a lot of fun nonetheless. You know, we got preempted by some other stuff, but still, the college radio day was a lot of fun. Anyway, we've got a pretty good program lined up for today. It's Veterans Day, so happy Veterans Day to everybody, to all our armed servicemen and veterans, of course. And to that end, I've actually got a couple of little things Army-themed. As with some other stuff that have been on this show, these things aren't horror in the, you know, frightening, jump-scare monsters sort of thing, but the horror of the situation, more like. There's a despair to them as well. They're both classic, stories and poems about war, you know, from times when we were at wars. For instance, this first thing is it's a poem by Randall Jarrell. It's titled The Death of the Ball Turret Gunner, and it was written during World War, I believe, II. Yeah, II. The Death of the Ball Turret Gunner by Randall Jarrell. From my mother's sleep, I fell into the state, and I hunched in its belly till my wet fur froze. 6 miles from Earth, loosed from its dream of life, I woke to black flak and the nightmare fighters. When I died, they washed me out of the turret with a hose. It's that last line that really makes this one as horrific as it is. I mean, they use some fairly, you know, unsettling imagery, but it's all very poetic until the final line just beats home the barbarity of what's being discussed. This next story is a short story, and it's simply titled The War, or War. And it is by a man named Luigi Pirandello, and it was published in, it was during one of the Great Wars, World War, it doesn't say, no matter. The message is the same. I believe it's during World War II, again, but the message is the same no matter what war it's from. War, by Luigi Pirandello. The passengers who had left Rome by the night express had had to stop until dawn in the small station of Fabriano in order to continue their journey by the small, old-fashioned local joining the main line with Solomuna. At dawn, in a stuffy and smoky second-class carriage, in which 5 people had already spent the night, a bulky woman in deep mourning was hoisted in, almost like a shapeless bundle. Behind her, puffing and moaning, followed her husband, a tiny man, thin and weakly, his face death-white, his eyes small and bright, and looking shy and uneasy. Having at last taken a seat, he politely thanked the passengers who had helped his wife, and who had made room for her. Then he turned round to the woman trying to pull down the collar of her coat and politely inquired, "Are you all right, my dear?" The wife, instead of answering, pulled up her collar again to her eyes so as to hide her face. "Nasty world," muttered the husband with a sad smile. And he felt it his duty to explain to his traveling companions that the poor woman was to be pitied, for the war was taking away from her only son, a boy of 20 to whom both had devoted their entire life, even breaking up their home at Solomuna to follow him to Rome, where he had to go as a student, then allowing him to volunteer for war with an assurance, however, that at least for 6 months he would not be sent to the front, and now, all of a sudden, receiving a wire saying that he was due to leave in 3 days' time, and asking them to go and see him off. The woman, under the big coat, was twisting and wriggling, at times growling like a wild animal, feeling certain that all those explanations would not have aroused even a shadow of sympathy from those people, who, most likely, were in the same plight as herself. One of them, who had been listening with particular attention, said, "You should thank God that your son is only leaving now for the front. Mine has been sent there the first day of the war. He has already come back twice wounded and been sent back again to the front. What about me? I have 2 sons and 3 nephews at the front," said another passenger. "Maybe, but in our case it is our only son," ventured the husband. "What difference can it make? You may spoil your only son with excessive attentions, but you cannot love him more than you would love all your other children if you had any. Paternal love is not like bread that can be broken into pieces and split amongst the children in equal shares. A father gives all his love to each of his children, without discrimination, whether it be one or ten. And if I am suffering now for my two sons, I am not suffering half for each of them, but double. True, sighed the embarrassed husband. But suppose, of course, we all hope it will never be your case, a father has two sons at the front, and he loses one of them. There is still one left to console him, while... Yes, answered the other, getting cross. A son left to console him, but also a son left for whom he must survive. While in the case of the father of an only son, if the son dies, the father can die too and put an end to his distress. Which of the two positions is worse? Don't you see how my case would be worse than yours? Nonsense, interrupted another traveler, a fat, red-faced man with bloodshot eyes of the palest gray. He was panting. From his bulging eyes seemed to spurt inner violence of an uncontrolled vitality which his weakened body could hardly contain. Nonsense, he repeated, trying to cover his mouth with his hand so as to hide the two missing front teeth. Nonsense. Do we give life to our children for our own benefit? The other travelers stared at him in distress. The one who had had his first son at the front since the first day of the war sighed. You are right. Our children do not belong to us. They belong to the country.
Bosh! Retorted the fat traveler. Do we think of the country when we give life to our children? Our sons are born because they must be born. And when they come to life, they take our own life with them. This is the truth. We belong to them, but they never belong to us. And when they reach 20, they are exactly what we were at their age. We, too, had a father and a mother, but there were so many other things as well. Girls, cigarettes, illusions, new ties. And the country, of course, whose call we would have answered when we were 20, even if father and mother had said no. Now, at our age, the love of our country is still great, of course, but stronger than it is, the love for our children. Is there any one of us here who wouldn't gladly take his son's place at the front if he could?
There was silence all round, everybody nodding as to approve.
Why then, continued the fat man, shouldn't we consider the feelings of our children when they are 20? Isn't it natural that at their age they should consider the love for their country, I am speaking of decent boys, of course, even greater than the love for us? Isn't it natural that it should be so? So, after all, they must look upon us as upon old boys who cannot move anymore and must stay at home. If country exists, if country is a natural necessity like bread, of which each of us must eat in order not to die of hunger, somebody must go to defend it. And our sons go, when they are 20, and they don't want tears, because if they die inflamed and happy. I am speaking, of course, of decent boys. Now, if one dies young and happy, without having the ugly sides of life, the boredom of it, the pettiness, the bitterness, the disillusion, what more can we ask of him? Everyone should stop crying. Everyone should laugh, as I do. Or at least thank God, as I do, because my son, before dying, sent me a message saying that he was dying satisfied at having ended his life in the best way he could have wished. That is why, as you see, I do not even wear mourning.
He shook his light fawn coat as to show it. His livid lip over his missing teeth was trembling. His eyes were watery and motionless, and soon after he ended with a shrill laugh which might well have been a sob.
Quite so, agreed the others.
The woman, who, bundled in a corner under her coat, had been sitting and listening, had, for the last 3 months, tried to find in the words of her husband and her friends something to console her in her deep sorrow, something that might show her how a mother should resign herself to send her son, not even to death, but to a probable danger of life. Yet not a word had she found amongst the many which had been said, and her grief had been greater in seeing that nobody, as she thought, could share her feelings. But now, the words of the traveler amazed and almost stunned her. She suddenly realized that it wasn't the others who were wrong and could not understand her, but herself
who could not rise up to the same height of those fathers and mothers willing to resign themselves, without crying, not only to the departure of their sons, but even to their death. She lifted her head. She bent over from her corner, trying to listen with great attention to the details which the fat man was giving to his companions about the way his son had fallen as a hero for his king and his country, happy and without regrets. It seemed to her that she had stumbled into a world she had never dreamt of, a world so far unknown to her, and she was so pleased to hear everyone joining in congratulating that brave father who could so stoically speak of his child's death. Then suddenly, just as if she had heard nothing of what had been said, and almost as if waking up from a dream, she turned to the old man, asking him, "Then, is your son really dead?" Everybody stared at her. The old man, too, turned to look at her, fixing his great, bulging, horribly watery, light gray eyes deep in her face. For some little time he tried to answer, but words failed him. He looked and looked at her, almost as if only then, at that silly, incongruous question, he had suddenly realized at last that his son was really dead. Gone forever. Forever. His face contracted, became horribly distorted. Then he snatched in haste a handkerchief from his pocket and, to the amazement of everyone, broke into harrowing, heart-rending, uncontrollable sobs. That was War by Luigi Pirandello. And as I said, it's not really horror in the traditional sense, but I mean the phrase horror of war exists for a reason, as does war is hell. And it seemed appropriate to read something like that today. It's a powerful ending, I think, one of the more powerful in terms of short stories I've read. Edgar Allan Poe once said that, you know, in his rules of short stories, that it should be able to be read in a sitting and should all work towards a singular effect. And it does. All the squabbling and the competition of who has it the worst and this man's attempt to say, no, it's perfect. This is exactly how it should be. And then that woman's one simple question. I mean, it's such a silly, stupid question. And it drives home the reality of him. He'd been fooling himself. He could accept his son's death because he hadn't accepted it. He was able to face it because he refused to admit it was real. And then he was forced to face the fact that, no, he's dead. And that's it. And he broke. And that's a horrible thing. Okay, let's stop depressing ourselves and go back to something a little more traditional. I mentioned Edgar Allan Poe, and now we're going to read a story by him, The Black Cat, published 1845. The Black Cat by Edgar Allan Poe. For the most wild yet homely narrative which I am about to pen, I neither expect nor solicit belief. Mad indeed would I be to expect it, in a case where my very senses reject their own evidence. Yet mad am I not, and very surely do I not dream. But tomorrow I die, and today I would unburden my soul. My immediate purpose is to place before the world, plainly, succinctly, and without comment, a series of mere household events. In their consequences, these events have terrified, have tortured, have destroyed me. Yet I will not attempt to expound them. To me, they have presented little but horror. To many, they will seem less terrible than baroques. Hereafter, perhaps, some intellect may be found which will reduce my phantasm to the commonplace, some intellect more calm, more logical, and far less excitable than my own, which will perceive, in the circumstances I detail with awe, nothing more than an ordinary succession of very natural causes and effects. From my infancy, I was noted for the docility and humanity of my disposition. My tenderness of heart was even so conspicuous as to make me the jest of my companions. I was especially fond of animals, and was indulged by my parents with a great variety of pets. With these I spent most of my time, and was never so happy as when feeding and caressing them. This peculiarity of character grew with my growth, and in my manhood I derived from it one of my principal sources of pleasure. To those who have cherished an affection for a faithful and sagacious dog, I need hardly be at the trouble of explaining the nature or the intensity of the gratification thus derivable. There is something
in the unselfish and self-sacrificing love of a brute, which goes directly to the heart of him who has had frequent occasion to test the paltry friendship and gossamer fidelity of mere man. I married early, and was happy to find my wife, a disposition not uncongenial with my own. Observing my partiality for domestic pets, she lost no opportunity of procuring those of the most agreeable kind. We had birds, goldfish, a fine dog, rabbits, a small monkey, and a cat. The latter was a remarkably large and beautiful animal, entirely black and sagacious to an astonishing degree. In speaking of his intelligence, my wife, who, at heart, was not a little tinctured with superstition, made frequent allusion to the ancient popular notion which regarded all black cats as witches in disguise. Not she was ever serious upon this point, and I mention the matter at all for no better reason than it happens just now to be remembered. Pluto. This was the cat's name. Was my favorite pet and playmate. I alone fed him, and he attended me wherever I went about the house. It was even with difficulty that I could prevent him from following me through the streets. Our friendship lasted in this matter for several years, during which my general temperament and character, though through the instrumentality of the fiend Intemperance, had, I blush to confess it, experienced a radical alteration for the worse. I grew day by day, more moody, more irritable, more regardless of the feelings of others. I suffered myself to use intemperate language to my wife. At length, I even offered her personal violence. My pets, of course, were made to feel the change in my disposition. I not only neglected, but ill-used them. For Pluto, however, I still retained sufficient regard to restrain me from maltreating him, as I made no scruple of maltreating the rabbits, the monkey, or even the dog, when, by accident or through affection, they came in my way. But my disease grew upon me, for what a disease is like alcohol. And at length, even Pluto, who was now becoming old and consequently somewhat peevish, even Pluto began to experience the effects of my ill temper. One night, returning home, much intoxicated from one of my haunts about town, I fancied that the cat avoided my presence. I seized him, when, in his fright at my violence, he inflicted a slight wound upon my hand with his teeth. The fury of a demon instantly possessed me. I knew myself no longer. My original soul seemed, at once, to take its flight from my body, and a more than fiendish malevolence, gin-nurtured, thrilled every fiber of my frame. I took from my waistcoat pocket, a penknife, opened it, grasped the poor beast by the throat, and deliberately cut one of its eyes from the socket. I blush, I burn, I shudder, while I pen the damnable atrocity. When reason returned with the morning, when I had slept off the fumes of the night's debauch, I experienced the sentiment half of horror, half of remorse, for the crime of which I had been guilty. But it was, at best, a feeble and equivocal feeling, and the soul remained untouched. I again plunged into excess, and soon drowned in wine all memory of the deed. In the meantime, the cat slowly recovered. The socket of the lost eye presented, it is true, a frightful appearance, but he no longer appeared to suffer any pain. He went through the house as usual, but, as might be expected, fled in extreme terror at my approach. I had so much of my old heart left as to be first grieved by this evident dislike on the part of a creature which had once so loved me. But this feeling soon gave place to irritation. And then came, as if to my final and irrevocable overthrow, the spirit of perverseness. Of this spirit, philosophy takes no account. Yet I am not more sure that my soul lives than I am that perverseness is one of the primitive impulses of the human heart, one of the indivisible primary faculties or sentiments which give direction to the character of man. Who has not, 100 times, found himself committing a vile or silly action for no other reason than because he knows he should not? Have we not a perpetual inclination in the teeth of our best judgment to violate that which is law, merely because we understand it to be such? This spirit of perverseness, I say, came to my final overthrow. It was this unfathomable longing of the soul to vex itself, to offer violence to its old nature, to do wrong for the wrong's sake only,
that urged me to continue and finally to consummate the injury I had inflicted upon the unoffending brute. One morning, in cold blood, I slipped a noose about its neck and hung it to the limb of a tree. Hung it with the tears streaming from my eyes and with the bitterest remorse in my heart. Hung it because I knew that it had loved me, and because I felt it had given me no reason of offense. Hung it because I knew that in so doing I was committing a sin, a deadly sin that would so jeopardize my immortal soul as to place it, if such a thing were possible, even beyond the reach of the infinite mercy of the most merciful and most terrible God. On the night of the day on which this cruel deed was done, I was aroused from sleep by the cry of fire. The curtains of my bed were in flames. The whole house was blazing. It was with great difficulty that my wife, a servant, and myself made our escape from the conflagration. The destruction was complete. My entire worldly wealth was swallowed up, and I resigned myself thenceforward to despair. I am above the weakness of seeking to establish a sequence of cause and effect between the disaster and the atrocity, but I am detailing a chain of facts and wish not to leave even a possible link imperfect. On the day succeeding the fire, I visited the ruins. The walls, with one exception, had fallen in. This exception found in a compartment wall, not very thick, which stood about the middle of the house, and against which had rested the head of my bed. The plastering had here, in great measure, resisted the action of the fire, a fact which I attribute to it having been recently spread. About this wall, a dense crowd were collected, and many persons seemed to be examining a particular portion of it with a very minute and eager attention. The words strange, singular, and other similar expressions excited my curiosity. I approached and saw, as if graven in bas relief upon the white surface, the figure of a gigantic cat. The impression was given with an accuracy truly marvelous. There was a rope about the animal's neck. When I first beheld this apparition, for I could scarcely regard it as less, my wonder and my terror were extreme. But at length, reflection came to my aid. The cat, I remembered, had been hung in the garden adjacent to the house. Upon the alarm of fire, the garden had been immediately filled by the crowd, by someone of whom the animal must have been cut down from the tree and thrown, through an open window, into my chamber. This had probably been done with the view of arousing me from sleep. The falling of other walls had compressed the victim of my cruelty into the substance of the freshly spread plaster, the lime of which, with the flames and the ammonia from the carcasses, had then accomplished the portraiture as I saw it. Although I thus readily accounted to my reason, if not altogether to my conscience, for the startling fact just detailed, it did not the less fail to make a deep impression upon my fancy. For months I could not rid myself of the phantasm of the cat, and during this period there came back into my spirit a half-sentiment that seemed, but was not, remorse. I went so far as to regret the loss of the animal, and to look about me among the vile haunts which I now habitually frequented, for another pet of the same species, and of somewhat similar appearance, for which to supply in its place. One night, as I sat, half-stupefied in a den of more than infamy, my attention was suddenly drawn to some black object reposing upon the head of one of the immense hogsheads of gin and or of rum, which constituted the chief furniture of the apartment. I had been looking steadily at the top of this hogshead for some minutes, and what now caused me surprise was the fact that I had not sooner perceived the object thereupon. I approached it and touched it with my hand. It was a black cat, a very large one, fully as large as Pluto, and as closely resembling him in every respect but one. Pluto had not a white hair upon any portion of his body, but this cat had a large, although indefinite, splotch of white, covering nearly the whole region of the breast. Upon my touching him, he immediately rose, purred loudly, rubbed against my hand, and appeared delighted with my notice. This, then, was the very creature of which I was in search. I had once offered to purchase it off of the landlord, but this person made no claim to it, knew nothing of it, had never seen it before. I continued my caresses, and when I prepared to go home, the animal evinced a disposition to accompany me. I permitted it to do so, occasionally stooping and patting it as I proceeded. When it reached the house, it domesticated itself at once and became immediately a great favorite with my wife. For my own part, I soon found a dislike to it arising within me. This was just the reverse of what I had anticipated, but I know not how or why it was. Its evident fondness for myself rather disgusted and annoyed. By slow degrees, these feelings of disgust and annoyance rose into the bitterness of hatred. I avoided the creature. A certain sense of shame and the remembrance of my former deed of cruelty preventing me from physically abusing it. I did not, for some weeks, strike or otherwise violently ill-use it, but gradually, very gradually, I came to look upon it with the unutterable loathing, and to flee silently from its odious presence as from the breath of a pestilence. What added, no doubt, to my hatred of the beast was the discovery, on the morning after I brought it home, that, like Pluto, it also had been deprived of one of its eyes. This circumstance, however, only endeared it to my wife, who, as I have already said, possessed, in a high degree, that humanity of feeling which I had once been my distinguishing trait, and the source of many of my simplest and purest pleasures. With my aversion to this cat, however, its partiality for myself seemed to increase. It followed my footsteps with a pertinacity with which it would be difficult to make the reader comprehend. Whenever I sat, it would crouch beneath my chair, or spring upon my knees, covering me with its loathsome caresses. If I arose to walk, it would get up between my feet, and thus nearly throw me down, or, fastening its long and sharp claws in my dress, clamber in this manner to my breast. At such times, although I longed to destroy it with a blow, I was yet withheld from so doing, partly by a memory of my former crime, but chiefly, let me confess it at once, by an absolute dread of the beast. The dread was not exactly a dread of physical evil, and yet I should be at a loss how otherwise to define it. I am almost ashamed to own. Yes, even in this felon's cell, I am almost ashamed to own that the terror and horror with which the animal inspired me had been heightened by one of the merest chimeras it would be possible to conceive. My wife had called my attention more than once to the character of the mark of white hair of which I have spoken, and which constituted the sole visible difference between the strange beast and the one I had destroyed. The reader will remember that this mark, although large, had been originally very indefinite. But by slow degrees, degrees nearly imperceptible, and which for a long time my reason struggled to reject as fanciful, it had at length assumed a rigorous distinctness of outline. It was now the representation of an object that I shudder to name. And for this, above all, I loathed and dreaded, and would have rid myself of the monster had I dared. It was now, I say, the image of a hideous, of a ghastly thing, of the gallows. Oh, mournful and terrible engine of horror and of crime, of agony and of death! And now was I indeed wretched beyond the wretchedness of mere humanity, and a brute beast whose fellow I had contemptuously destroyed, a brute beast to work out for me, a man fashioned in the image of the high God, so much of insufferable woe, alas! Neither by day nor by night knew I the blessing of rest any more. During the former, the creature left me no moment alone, and in the latter, I started hourly from dreams of unutterable fear to find the hot breath of the thing on my face, and its vast weight, an incarnate nightmare that I had no power to shake off, incumbent eternally upon my heart. Beneath the pressure of torments such as these, the feeble remnant of the good within me succumbed. Evil thoughts became my sole intimates, the darkest and most evil of thoughts. The moodiness of my usual temper increased to hatred of all things and of all mankind, while from the sudden, frequent, and ungovernable outbursts of a fury to which I now blindly abandoned myself, my uncomplaining wife, alas, was the most usual and the most patient of sufferers. One day she accompanied me, upon some household errand, into the cellar of the old building which our property compelled us to inhabit. The cat followed me down the steep stairs, and, nearly throwing me headlong, exasperated me to madness. Uplifting an axe, and forgetting, in my wrath, the childish dread which had hitherto stayed my hand, I aimed a blow at the animal, which, of course, would have proved instantly fatal had it descended as I wish. But this blow was arrested by the hand of my wife. Goaded by the interference into a rage more than demoniacal, I withdrew my arm from her grasp and buried the axe in her brain. She fell dead upon the spot without a groan. This hideous murder accomplished, I set myself forthwith, and with the entire deliberation, to the task of concealing the body. I knew that I could not remove it from the house, either by day or by night, without the risk of being observed by the neighbors. Many projects entered my mind. At one period, I thought of cutting the corpse into minute fragments and destroying them by fire. At another, I resolved to dig a grave for it in the floor of the cellar. Again, I deliberated about casting it in the well in the yard, about packing it in a box, as if merchandise, with the usual arrangements, and so getting a porter to take it from the house. Finally, I hit upon what I considered a far better expedient than either of these. I determined to wall it up in the cellar, as the monks of the Middle Ages are recorded to have walled up their victims. For a purpose such as this, the cellar was well adapted. Its walls were loosely constructed, and had lately been plastered throughout with a rough plaster, which the dampness of the atmosphere had prevented from hardening. Moreover, in one of the walls was a projection caused by a false chimney or fireplace that had been filled up, and made to resemble the rest of the cellar. I made no doubt that I could readily displace the bricks at this point, insert the corpse, and wall the hole up as before, so that no eye could detect anything suspicious. And in this calculation I was not deceived. By means of a crowbar, I easily dislodged the bricks, and having carefully deposited the body against the inner wall, I propped it in that position while, with a little trouble, relaid the whole structure as it originally stood. Having procured mortar, sand, and hair, with every possible precaution, I prepared a plaster which could not be distinguished from the old, and with this I very carefully went over the new brickwork. When I had finished, I felt satisfied that all was right. The wall did not present the slightest appearance of having been disturbed. The rubbish on the floor was picked up with the minutest care. I looked around triumphantly and said to myself, "Here, at least, then, my labor has not been in vain." My next step was to look for the beast which had been the cause of so much wretchedness, for I had, at length, finally resolved to put it to death. Had I been able to meet with it at that moment, there could have been no doubt of its fate, but it appeared that the crafty animal had been alarmed at the violence of my previous anger, and forbore to present itself in my present mood. It is impossible to describe or to imagine the deep, the blissful sense of relief which the absence of the detested creature occasioned in my bosom. It did not make its appearance during the night, and thus, for one night, at least, since its introduction into the house, I soundly and tranquilly slept. I slept even with the burden of murder upon my soul. The second and the third day passed, and still my tormentor came not. Once again I breathed as a free man. The monster, in terror, had fled the premises forever. I should behold it no more. My happiness was supreme. The guilt of my dark deed disturbed me but a little. Some few inquiries had been made, but these had been readily answered. Even a search had been instituted, but of course nothing was to be discovered. I looked upon my future felicity as secured. Upon the fourth day of the assassination, a party of the police came, very unexpectedly, into the house and proceeded again to make a rigorous investigation of the premises. Secure, however, in the inscrutability of my place of concealment, I felt no embarrassment whatsoever. The officer bade me accompany them in their search. They left no nook or corner unexplored. At length, for the third or fourth time, they descended into the cellar. I quivered not a muscle. My heart beat calmly, as that of one who slumbers in innocence. I walked the cellar from end to end. I folded my arms upon my bosom and roamed easily to and fro. The police were thoroughly satisfied and prepared to depart. The glee at my heart was too strong to be restrained. I burned to say if but one word by way of triumph, and to render doubly sure their assurance of my guiltlessness. "Gentlemen," I said at last, as the party ascended the steps, "I delight to have allayed your suspicions. I wish you all health, and a little more courtesy. By the by, gentlemen, this is a very well-constructed house." In the rabid desire to say something easily, I scarcely knew what I uttered at all. "I mean, I may say, an excellently well-constructed house. These walls, are you going, gentlemen? These walls are solidly put together." And here, through the mere frenzy of bravado, I rapped heavily, with a cane which I held in my hand, upon that very portion of the brickwork behind which stood the corpse of the wife of my bosom. But may God shield me and deliver me from the fangs of the arch-fiend. No sooner had the reverberation of my blow sunk into silence than it was answered by a voice from within the tomb, by a cry, at first muffled and broken like the sobbing of a child, and then quickly swelling into one long, loud, and continuous scream, utterly anomalous and inhuman, a howl, a wailing shriek, half of horror and half of triumph, such as might have arisen only out of hell, conjointly from the throats of the damned in their agony and of the demons that exult in the damnation. Of my own thoughts it is folly to speak. Swooning, I staggered to the opposite wall. For one instant the party upon the stairs remained motionless, through extremity of terror and of awe. In the next, a dozen stout arms were toiling at the wall. It fell bodily. The corpse, already greatly decayed and clotted with gore, stood erect before the eyes of the spectators. Upon its head, with red, extended mouth and solitary eye of fire, sat the hideous beast whose craft had seduced me into murder and whose informing voice had consigned me to the hangman. I had walled the monster up within the tomb. And that was Edgar Allan Poe's The Black Cat. Some narrative similarities to The Telltale Heart, for those who are familiar with that story. Another one where a man commits a murder and walls a body up, this time in the floor, and the beating of the dead man's heart drives him to a crazed confession. Up next, we're going to do a little bit of poetry, I think. And we're going to start with a poem titled "Did You Ever Stand in a Cavern's Mouth?" by Emily Dickinson. Dickinson is a personal favorite of mine. Her stuff has a macabre... what's the word I'm looking for? It's an S word. It's macabre, it's gothic, it's dignified, it's... this word is going to haunt me. It's like autumnal, solemn, something like that. It'll come to me at some point. At any rate, it's not horrific, but it's got all the trappings. Here we are. "Did You Ever Stand in a Cavern's Mouth?" by Emily Dickinson. Did you ever stand in a cavern's mouth, widths out of the sun, and look and shudder and block your path, and deem to be alone in such a place? What horror! How goblin it would be! And fly as 'twere pursuing you? Then loneliness looks so. Did you ever look in a cannon's face, between whose yellow eye and yours the judgment intervened, the question of to die, exemplarizing in your ear, as cool as satyr's drums, if you remember and were saved? It's liker so, it seems." It's a poem by Emily Dickinson. "Did you ever stand in a cavern's mouth?" Her poetry's weird. Somber is the word I couldn't think of just a moment ago. We have another bit of poetry. This is by Sylvia Plath. It's "The Mad Girl's Love Song." "Mad Girl's Love Song" by Sylvia Plath. "I shut my eyes and all the world drops dead. I lift my eyes and all is born again. I think I made you up inside my head. The stars go waltzing out in blue and red, and arbitrary blackness gallops in. I shut my eyes and all the world drops dead. I dreamed that you bewitched me into bed and sung me moonstruck, quick kissed me quite insane. I think I made you up inside my head. God topples from the sky, hell's fires fade, exit seraphim and Satan's men. I shut my eyes and all the world drops dead. I fancy you'd return the way you said, but I grow old and I forget your name. I think I made you up inside my head. I should have loved a thunderbird instead. At least when spring comes, they roar back again. I shut my eyes and all the world drops dead. I think I made you up inside my head. That was the Mad Girl's Love Song by Sylvia Plath. It's an unsettling little bit of poetry. This next bit is titled The Spider and the Fly, a Fable by Mary Howitt. The Spider and the Fly, a Fable. Will you walk into my parlor? Said the spider to the fly. 'Tis the prettiest little parlor that ever you did spy. The way into my parlor is up a winding stair, and I have many pretty things to show when you are there. Oh, no, no, said the little fly, to ask me is in vain, for who goes up your winding stair can ne'er come down again. I'm sure you must be weary, dear, with soaring up so high. Will you rest upon my little bed? Said the spider to the fly. There are pretty curtains drawn around, and sheets are fine and thin, and if you like to rest a while, I'll snugly tuck you in. Oh, no, no, said the little fly, for I've often heard it said, they never, never wake again who sleep upon your bed. Said the cunning spider to the fly, dear friend, what shall I do to prove the warm affection I've always felt for you? I have within my pantry good store of all that's nice. I'm sure you're very welcome. Will you please to take a slice? Oh, no, no, said the little fly. Kind sir, that cannot be. I've heard what's in your pantry, and I do not wish to see. Sweet creature, said the spider, you're witty and you're wise. How handsome are your gauzy wings, how brilliant are your eyes. I have a little looking-glass upon my parlor shelf. If you'll step in one moment, dear, you shall behold yourself. I thank you, gentle sir, she said, for what you're pleased to say, and bidding you good morrow now, I'll call another day. The spider turned him round about and went into his den, for well he knew the silly fly would soon be back again. So he wove a subtle web in a little corner sly, and set his table ready to dine upon the fly. Then he came out to his door again, and merrily did sing, Come hither, hither, pretty fly, with the pearl and silver wing. Your robes are green and purple, there's a crest upon your head. Your eyes are like the diamond bright, but mine are dull as lead. Alas, alas, how very soon this silly little fly, hearing his wily flattering words, came slowly flitting by. With buzzing wings she hung aloft, then near and nearer drew, thinking only of her brilliant eyes and green and purple hue, thinking only of her crested head. Poor foolish thing, at last up jumped the cunning spider and fiercely held her fast. He dragged her up his winding stair into his dismal den, within his little parlor, but she ne'er came out again. And now, dear little children, who may this story read, to idle, silly, flattering words, I pray, you ne'er give heed. Unto an evil counselor, close heart and ear and eye, and take a lesson from this tale of the spider and the fly. You know, I actually had the chance to own a picture book. They made a lovely little picture book with excellent illustrations when I was a small child in elementary school in the first grade. We even saw a little little video on how it was made by the author, by the illustrator. But the thing was, I was rather a bit of a sensitive child, and I was in the book fair, and I was flipping through it as we were in the checkout line, and I noticed the ending with the little ghost of the fly looking at her grave and Arilla and the spider dabbing his lips with his napkin, and I freaked out and I didn't want to own the book, and so we returned it and got different ones. Good books still.
And I'll have to look into getting it again because the illustrations really were quite superb. But it's funny to think that I went from that to, you know, the host of a radio show reading these sorts of things. So yeah, that's a bit of an odd little fact. But, you know, no matter, people change, and that is how it goes. We have one more bit of poetry, I think. I had it somewhere. Oh, what was I thinking? You know, here's something. Here's something fun. Spider and the Fly, if I may. Sorry, I had something and it's disappeared from my mind what it was going to be. But, I will think of something momentarily. In the meantime, though, like I say, excellent little story there. And, you know, I think we're just going to cut to the music so that I can get a little extra time to read through the Graveyard Book when we resume on that. Because I might actually be able to get to the end today. Unlikely, but possible. So we're going to cut to the music then. What I wanted to mention, that was it. The Spider and the Fly, it was the inspiration, partially, for the poem The Lobster Quadrille in Lewis Carroll's Alice's Adventures in Wonderland. It's the opening verse mimics the pattern. Will you walk into my parlor, said the spider to the fly. Will you walk a little faster, said a whiting to a snail. After that, it switches a little bit, and it's not making fun of it. A lot of the poems in Alice in Wonderland make fun of things. How doth the little crocodile mocks, how doth the little busy bee. To the point where most of those poems that he was making fun of are only remembered because he made fun of them. The Spider and the Fly is the rare one that is famous enough on its own. Anyway, we're now going to go with some songs. And again, it's Veterans Day, so we're going to play something. I've played a couple of different versions of the Hearse song in the past, The Worms Crawl In. But here's a version by the artist Oscar Brand from his album Cough, Army Songs Out of the Barracks Bag. And it's sort of an army take on it with the same sort of dark humor, but with an army spin. So in honor of Veterans Day, Oscar Brand's take on the Hearse song.
Have you ever thought as the hearse goes by, one of these days you are gonna die? The motor pool sends out a car, you're gone for a ride but you don't get far. As you watch the death wagon riding by, you don't know whether to laugh or cry. You wish it weren't, but you know it's true, the very next load may consist of you. The burial detail lowers you down. The officers, they just stand around. They shovel in dirt, they shovel in rocks. They don't give a damn if they break the box. The worms crawl in, the worms crawl out. They creep all over your chin and mouth. They call their friends, friends too. You look like hell when they get through. Your eyes drop out, your teeth fall in, the worms are over your mouth and chin. Each one takes a bite or two of what the Pentagon says is you.
Yeah, that was fun. Up next, we've got a song called Red Right Hand by Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds. So let's let him take it away.
Take a little walk to the edge of town and go across the track where the viaduct looms like a bird of doom as it ships and cracks, where secrets lie in the border fires and the humming wires. Yeah, man, you know you're never coming back. Across the square, across the bridge, past the mills, past the stacks, on a
gathering storm comes a tall, handsome man in a dusty black coat with a red right hand. Wrap you in his arms, tell you that you've been a good boy. He'll rekindle all the dreams that took you a lifetime to destroy. He'll reach deep into the hole, heal your shrinking soul, but there won't be a single thing that you can do. He's a god, he's a man, he's a ghost, he's a guru. They're whispering his name through this disappearing land, but hidden in his coat is a red right hand. You don't owe no money, get you some. You don't have no car, get you one. Self-respect, you feel like an insect. Well, don't you worry, buddy, 'cause here he comes through the ghettos and the barrio and the barry and the slum. His shadow is cast wherever he stands. Stacks of green paper in his red right hand.
And that was Red Right Hand by Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds. And for our final song on the venue tonight, we've got a cover of the classic They Are Coming to Take Me Away, haha, by the band Neurotic Fish. That's one word, Neurotic Fish, and I just love that name. So here we go.
We're I've gone completely out of my mind. And they're coming to take me away, ha-ha. They're coming to take me away, ho-ho, hee-hee, ha-ha. To the funny farm where life is beautiful all the time. And I'll be happy to see those nice young men with their clean white coats. And they're coming to take me away, ha-ha. They're coming to take me away, ha-ha. They're coming to take me away, ho-ho, hee-hee, ha-ha. To the funny farm where life is beautiful all the time. And I'll be happy to see those nice young men with their clean white coats. And they're coming to take me away, ha-ha. Thought it was a joke, and so you laughed, you laughed, when I have said that losing you would make me flip my lid. Right? You know you laughed, I heard you laughed, you laughed, you laughed, and laughed, and then you left, but now you know I'm utterly mad. And they're coming to take me away, haha. They're coming to take me away, ho ho, hee hee, haha. To the funny farm where life is beautiful all the time, and I'll be happy to see those nice young men with their clean white coats, and they're coming to take me away, haha. They're coming to take me away, ha-ha. They're coming to take me away, ho-ho, hee-hee, ha-ha. To the happy home with trees and flowers and chipping birds and basket weavers who sit and smile and twiddle their thumbs and toes. And they're coming to take me away, ha-ha. I cooked your food, I cleaned your house, and this is how you pay me back for all my kind, unselfish, loving deeds? Huh? Well, you just wait, they find you yet, and when they do, they put you in the ASPCA, you mangy mutt. They're coming to take me away, haha. They're coming to take me away, ho ho, hee haha. To the funny farm where life is beautiful all the time, and I'll be happy to see those nice young men with their clean white coats, and they're coming to take me away, haha. They're coming to take me away, haha. They're coming to take me away, ho ho. Home with trees and flowers and chipping birds and basket weavers who sit and smile and twiddle their thumbs and toes. They're coming to take me away, ha-ha! They're coming to take me away! 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 They're coming to take me away!
Yeah, that was fun. All right, now we are back for the second hour of our show, and we will be reading some more of The Graveyard Book by Neil Gaiman, possibly even finishing it out in the hour. I'm not sure. A brief recap. The Graveyard Book is the story of young Nobody Owens, Bod, as most people call him, who lives in a graveyard with his adoptive parents, the ghosts of Mr. and Mrs. Owens. Bod's actual family were killed when he was just an infant by the man Jack, and so he was adopted. He's got freedom of the graveyard, he can move around in there, go through things, he's got a lot of abilities ghost types would have, but he's alive, he's perfectly alive, and the ghosts want him to stay alive so that he can go out and live his life. He also has his guardian Silas, his a vampire, his teacher Miss Lupescu, a woman who is also a werewolf. And he's joined by his friend, the little girl Scarlet, who he knew when he was a very small child. Then she moved to Scotland, and now she's recently moved back, and they were reconnected. However, Scarlet's friend, when she moved back, an elderly gentleman named Mr. Frost, has turned out to be the man Jack, who's been seeking Bod all this time. Several other men from the Jacks of All Trades Society have also come, and they've hunted Bod into the graveyard, where he is now attempting to get rid of them. And when we had last left Bod, he had just gotten Jack Ketch to fall into an open grave, break his ankle, and be trapped at the bottom of it. So that's one down, three to go. He passed the old apple tree. "There's four of them still," said a tart female voice. "Four of them, and all killers. And the rest won't all of them fall into open graves to oblige you." "Hello, Liza. I thought you were angry at me." "I might be and I mightn't," she said, nothing more than a voice. "But I'm not going to let them cut you up, nohow." "Then trip them up for me. Trip them and confuse them and slow them down. Can you do that?"
While you runs away again, nobody Owens, why don't you just fade and hide in your mam's nice tomb where they'll never find you, and soon enough Silas will be back to take care of them.
Maybe he will and maybe he won't, said Bod. I'll meet you by the lightning tree.
I'm still not talking to you,
said Liza Hempstock's voice, proud as a peacock and pert as a sparrow.
Actually, you are. I mean, we're talking right now. Only during this emergency. After that, not a word.
Bod made for the lightning tree, an oak that had been burned by lightning 20 years ago, and was now nothing more than the blackened limb clutching at the sky. He had an idea. It was not fully formed. It depended on whether he could remember Miss Lupescu's lessons, remember everything he had seen and heard as a child. It was harder to find the grave than he had expected, even looking for it, but he found it. An ugly grave, tipped at an odd angle, its stone topped by a headless, water-stained angel that had the appearance of a gargantuan fungus. It was only when he felt it, touched it, and felt the chill that he knew it for certain. He sat down on the grave, forced himself to become entirely visible.
"You've not faded," said Liza's voice. "Anyone could find you."
"Good," said Bod. "I want them to find me."
"More know Jack Fool than Jack Fool knows," said Liza.
The moon was rising. It was huge now and low in the sky. Bod wondered if it would be overdoing it if he began to whistle.
"I can see him."
A man ran towards him, tripping and stumbling, two other men close behind. Bod was aware of the dead clustered around them, watching the scene, but he forced himself to ignore them. He made himself more comfortable on the ugly grave. He felt like the bait in a trap, and it was not a good feeling. The bull-like man was the first to reach the grave, followed closely by the man with the white hair who had done all the talking, and the tall blonde man. Bod stayed where he was. The man with the white hair said,
"Ah, the elusive Dorian boy, I presume. Astonishing. There's our Jack Frost hunting the whole world over, and here you are, just where he left you, 13 years ago."
Bod said, "That man killed my family."
"Indeed he did."
"Why?
Does it matter? You're never going to tell anyone."
"Then it's no skin off your nose to tell me, is it?"
The white-haired man barked a laugh. "Funny boy! What I want to know is how have you lived in a graveyard for 13 years without anyone catching wise?"
"I'll answer your question if you'll answer mine,"
the bull-necked man said.
"You don't talk to Mr. Dandy like that, little snot! I split you, I will!"
The white-haired man took another step closer to the grave.
"Hush, Jack Tar."
"All right, an answer for an answer." Ooh, excuse me. "All right, an answer for an answer. We, my friends and I, are members of a fraternal organization known as the Jacks of All Trades, or the Knaves, or by other names. We go back an extremely long way. We know. We remember things that most people have forgotten. The old magic. The old knowledge."
Bod said, "Magic. You know a little magic."
The man nodded agreeably. "If you want to call it that. But it is a very specific sort of magic. There's a magic you take from death. Something leaves the world. Something else comes into it. You killed my family for what? For magic powers? That's ridiculous. No, we killed you for protection. Long ago, one of our people, this was back in Egypt, in pyramid days, he foresaw that one day there would be a child born who would walk the borderland between the living and the dead. That if this child grew to adulthood, it would mean the end of our order and all we stand for. We had people casting nativities before London was a village. We had your family in our sights before New Amsterdam became New York. We sent what we thought was the best and the sharpest and the most dangerous of all the jacks to deal with you. To do it properly, so we could take all the bad juju and make it work for us instead, and keep everything tickety-boo for another 5,000 years. Only he didn't.
Bod looked at the three men.
"So where is he? Why isn't he here?" The blonde man said,
"We can take care of you.
He's got a good nose on him, has our Jack Frost. He's on the trail of your little girlfriend. Can't leave any witnesses, not to something like this. Bod leaned forward, dug his hands into the wild weed grass that grew on the unkempt grave. Come and get me, was all that he said. The blonde man grinned. The bull-necked man lunged, and yes, even Mr. Dandy took several steps forward. Bod pushed his fingers as deeply as he could into the grass and pulled his lips back from his teeth, and he said three words in a language that was already ancient before the Indigo Man was born.
Skog! Thak! Kabaka!
He opened the ghoul gate. The grave swung open like a trap door. In the deep hole below the door, Bod could see stars, a darkness filled with glimmering lights. The bull man, Mr. Tar, at the edge of the hole, could not stop, and stumbled, surprised, into the darkness. Mr. Nimble jumped towards Bod, his arms extended, leaping over the hole. Bod watched as the man stopped in the air at the zenith of his spring, hung there for a moment, before he was sucked through the ghoul gate, down and down. Mr. Dandy stood at the edge of the ghoul gate on a lip of stone and looked down into the darkness beneath. Then he raised his eyes to Bod, and, thin-lipped, he smiled. "I don't know what you just did," said Mr. Dandy, "but it didn't work." He pulled his gloved hand out of his pocket, holding a gun pointed directly at Bod. "I should have just done this 13 years ago," said Mr. Dandy. "You can't trust other people. If it's important, you have to do it yourself." The desert wind came up from the open ghoul gate, hot and dry, with grit in it. Bod said, "There's a desert down there. If you look for water, you should find some. There's things to eat if you look hard, but don't antagonize the night gaunts. Avoid Ghoulheim. The ghouls might wipe your memories and make you into one of them, or they might wait until you've rotted down and then eat you. Either way, you can do better." The gun barrel did not waver. Mr. Dandy said, "Why are you telling me this?" Bod pointed across the graveyard. "Because of them," he said. And as he said it, Mr. Dandy glanced away only for a moment, and Bod fainted. Mr. Dandy's eyes flickered away and back, but Bod was no longer by the broken statue. From deep in the hole, something called, like the lonely wail of a nightbird. Mr. Dandy looked around, his forehead a slash, his body a mass of indecision and rage. "Where are you?" he growled. "The deuce take you, where are you?" He thought he heard a voice say, "Ghoul gates are made to be opened and then closed again. You can't leave them open. They want to close." The lip of the hole shuddered and shook. Mr. Dandy had been in an earthquake once, years before, in Bangladesh. It felt like that. The earth juddered, and Mr. Dandy fell, would have fallen into the darkness, but he caught hold of the fallen headstone, threw his arms about it, and locked on. He did not know what was beneath him, only that he had no wish to find out. The earth shook, and he felt the headstone begin to shift beneath his weight. He looked up. The boy was there, looking down at him curiously. "I'm going to let the gate close now," he said. "I think if you keep holding on to that thing, it might close on you and crush you, or it might just absorb you and make you into part of the gate. Don't know, but I'm giving you a chance, more than you ever gave my family. A ragged judder. Mr. Dandy looked up into the boy's gray eyes and he swore. Then he said, "You can't ever escape us. We're the jacks of all trades. We're everywhere. It's not over." "It is for you," said Bod. "The end of your people and all you stand for. Like your man in Egypt predicted. You didn't kill me. You were everywhere. Now it's all over." Then Bod smiled. "That's what Silas is doing, isn't it? That's where he is." Mr. Dandy's face confirmed everything that Bod had suspected. And what Mr. Dandy might have said to that, Bod would never know, because the man let go of the headstone and tumbled slowly down into the open ghoul gate. Bod said, "Weg Carados!" The ghoul gate was a grave once again, nothing more. Something was tugging at his sleeve. Fortinbras Bartleby looked up at him.
"Bod, the man by the chapel, he's going up the hill!"
The man Jack followed his nose. He had left the other, not least because the stink of Jack Dandy's cologne made finding anything subtler impossible. He could not find the boy by scent. Not here. The boy smelled like the graveyard. But the girl smelled like her mother's house, like the dab of perfume she had touched to her neck before school that morning. She smelled like a victim, too, like fear sweat, thought Jack, to his like his quarry. And wherever she was, the boy would be too, sooner or later. His hand closed around the handle of his knife, and he walked up the hill. He was almost at the top of the hill when it occurred to him, a hunch he knew was a truth, that Jack Dandy and the rest of them were gone. Good, he thought. There's always room at the top. The man Jack's own rise through the order had slowed and stopped after he had failed to kill all of the Dorian family. It was as if he had no longer been trusted. Now, soon, everything would change. At the top of the hill, the man Jack lost the girl's scent. He knew she was near. He retraced his steps almost casually, caught her perfume again about 50 feet away, beside a small mausoleum with a closed metal gateway. He pulled on the gate, and it swung wide. Her scent was strong now. He could smell that she was afraid. He pulled down the coffins one by one from their shelves and let them clatter onto the ground, shattering the old wood, spilling their contents onto the mausoleum floor. No, she was not hiding in any of those. Then where? He examined the wall. Solid. He went down on his hands and knees, pulled the last coffin out, and reached back. His hand found an opening. Scarlet, he called, trying to remember how he would have called her name when he was Mr. Frost, but he could not even find that part of himself any longer. He was the man Jack now, and that was all he was. On his hands and knees, he crawled through the hole in the wall. When Scarlet heard the crashing noise from above, she made her way, carefully, down the steps, her left hand touching the wall, her right hand holding the little LED keyring, which cast just enough light to allow her to see where she was placing her feet. She made it to the bottom of the stone steps and edged back in the open chamber, her heart thumping. She was scared. Scared of nice Mr. Frost and his scarier friends, scared of this room and its memories, even, if she were honest, a little afraid of Bod. He was no longer a quiet boy with a mystery, a link to her childhood. He was something different, something not quite human. She thought, I wonder what Mum's thinking right now. She'll be phoning Mr. Frost's house over and over to find out when I'm going to be back. She thought, if I get out of this alive, I'm going to force her to get me a phone. It's ridiculous. I'm the only person in my year who doesn't have her own phone, practically. She thought, I miss my mum. She had not thought anyone human could move that silently through the dark, but a gloved hand closed upon her mouth, and a voice that was only barely recognizable as Mr. Frost said, Do anything clever, do anything at all, and I will cut your throat. Nod if you understand me. Scarlet nodded. Bod saw the chaos on the floor of the Frobisher Mausoleum, the fallen coffins with their contents scattered across the aisle. There were many Frobishers and Frobishers and several Pettifers, all in various states of upset and consternation. "He is already down there," said Ephiram. "Thank you," said Bod. He clambered through the hole into the inside of the hill and went down the stairs. Bod saw as the Dead Sea. He saw the steps, and he saw the chamber at the bottom. When he got halfway down the steps, he saw the man Jack holding Scarlet. He had her arm twisted up behind her back, and a large, wicked boning knife at her neck. The man Jack looked up in the darkness. "Hello, boy," he said. Bod said nothing. He concentrated on his fade, took another step. "You think I can't see you?" said the man Jack. "And you're right, I can't. Not really, but I can smell your fear, and I can hear you move and hear you breathe, and now that I know about your clever vanishing trick, I can feel you. Say something now.
Say it so I can hear it, or I start to cut little pieces out of the young lady. Do you understand me?
Yes, said Bod, his voice echoing in the chamber room. I understand.
Good, said Jack. Now come here. Let's have a little chat.
Bod began to walk down the steps. He concentrated on the fear, on raising the level of panic in the room, of making the terror something tangible.
Stop that, said the man Jack. Whatever it is you're doing, don't do it.
Bod let it go.
You think, that said Jack, that you can do your little magics on me? Do you know what I am, boy?
Bod said, you're a Jack. You killed my family, and you should have killed me. Jack raised an eyebrow. He said,
I should have killed you?
Oh, yes. The old man said that if you let me grow to adulthood, your order would be destroyed. I did. You failed, and you lost.
My order goes back before Babylon. Nothing can harm it.
They didn't tell you, did they? Bod was standing 5 paces from the man Jack. Those four. They were the last of the Jacks. What was it? Krakow and Vancouver and Melbourne. All gone. Scarlet said,
Please, Bod, make him let go of me.
Don't worry, said Bod, with a calm he did not feel. He said to Jack, There's no point in hurting her. There's no point in killing me. Don't you understand? There isn't even an order of Jacks of all trades. Not anymore. Jack nodded thoughtfully.
If this is true, said Jack, and if I am now a Jack all alone, then I have an excellent reason for killing you both.
Bod said nothing.
Pride, said the man Jack. Pride in my work. Pride in finishing what I began.
And then he said,
What are you doing?
Bod's hair prickled. He could feel a smoke tendril pressing and twining through the room. He said, It's not me. It's the Sleer. It guards the treasure that's buried here.
Don't lie,
Scarlet said.
He's not lying. It's true.
Jack said,
True? Buried treasure? Don't make me... The Sleer guards the treasure for the Master. Who said that?
Asked the man Jack, looking around. You heard it? Asked Bod, puzzled.
I heard it, said Jack. Yes.
I didn't hear anything, Scarlet said.
The man Jack said,
What is this place, boy? Where are we?
Before Bod could speak, the Sleer's voice spoke, echoing through the chamber.
This is the place of the treasure. This is the place of power. This is where the Sleer guards and waits for its master to return.
Bod said,
Jack?
The man Jack tilted his head on one side. He said,
It's good to hear my name in your mouth, boy. If you'd used it before, I would have found you sooner.
Jack, what was my real name? What did my family call me?
Bod said, The Sleer told... What did my family call me?
Why should it that matter to you now?
Bod said, The Sleer told me to find my name. What was it? Jack said,
Let me see. Was it Peter? Or Paul? Or Roderick? You look like a Roderick. Maybe you were a Stephen.
He was playing with the boy. You might as well tell me. You're going to kill me anyway, said Bod. Jack shrugged and nodded in the darkness, as if to say, obviously. I want you to let the girl go, said Bod. Let Scarlet go. Jack peered into the darkness, then said,
That's an altar stone, isn't it?
I suppose so.
And a knife? And a cup? And a brooch?
He was smiling now in the darkness. Bod could see it on his face. A strange, delighted smile that seemed out of place on that face. A smile of discovery and of understanding. Scarlet couldn't see anything but a blackness that sometimes erupted in flashes inside of her eyeballs, but she could hear the delight in Jack's voice. The man Jack said,
So the Brotherhood is over, and the Convocation is at an end. And yet, if there are no more jacks of all trades but me, what does it matter? There can be a new Brotherhood more powerful than the last.
Power!
Echoed the Sleer.
This is perfect, said the man Jack. Look at us. We are in a place for which many people have hunted for thousands of years, with everything necessary for the ceremony waiting for us. It makes you believe in Providence, doesn't it? Or in the massed prayers of all the jacks who have gone before us, that at our lowest ebb, we are given this.
Bod could feel the Sleer listening to Jack's words, could feel a surasus of excitement building in the chamber. The man Jack said,
I am going to put out my hand, boy. Scarlet, my knife is still at your throat. Do not try to run when I let go of you. Boy, you will place the cup and the brooch and the knife in my hand.
The treasure of the Sleer, whispered the triple voice. It always comes back. We guard it for the master.
Bod bent down, took the objects from the altar stone, put them in Jack's open gloved hand. Jack grinned.
Scarlet, I am going to release you. When I take the knife away, I want you to lie face down on the ground with your hands behind your head. Move or try anything, and I will kill you painfully. Do you understand?
She gulped. Her mouth was dry, but she took one shaky step forward. Her right arm, which had been twisted up to the small of her back, was now numb, and she felt only pins and needles in her shoulder. She lay down, her cheek resting on the packed earth. We are dead, she thought, and it was not even tinged with emotion. It felt as if she were watching something happening to other people, a surreal drama that had turned into a game of murder in the dark. She heard the noise of Jack taking hold of Bod. Bod's voice said, Let her go. The man Jack's voice.
If you do everything I say, I won't kill her. I won't even hurt her.
I don't believe you. She can identify you.
No, the adult voice seemed certain. She can't.
And then it said,
10,000 years and the knife is still sharp.
The admiration in the voice was palpable.
Boy, go and kneel on that altar stone. Hands behind your back. Now.
It has been so long,
said the Sleer, but all Scarlet heard was a slithering noise, as if of enormous coils winding around the chamber. But the man Jack heard,
You want to know your name, boy, before I spill your blood on the stone.
Bod felt the cold of the knife at his neck, and in that moment, Bod understood. Everything slowed. Everything came into focus. I know my name, he said. I'm Nobody Owens. That's who I am. And kneeling on the cold altar stone, it all seemed very simple. Sleer, he said to the chamber, do you still want a master?
The Sleer guards the treasure until the master returns.
Well, said Bod, haven't you found the master you've been looking for? He could sense the Sleer writhing and expanding, hear a noise like the scratching of 1,000 dead twigs, as if something huge and muscular were shaking its way around the inside of the chamber. And then for the first time, Bod saw the Sleer. Afterwards, he was never able to describe what he had seen. Something huge, yes, something with the body of an enormous snake, but with the head of, what? There were three of them. Three heads, three necks. The faces were dead, as if someone had constructed dolls from parts of the corpses of humans and of animals. The faces were covered in purple patterns, tattooed in swirls of indigo, turning the dead faces into strange, expressive, monstrous things. The faces of the Sleer nuzzled the air about Jack tentatively, as if they wanted to stroke or caress him.
What's happening? Said Jack. What is it? What does it do?
It's called the Sleer. It guards the place. It needs a master to tell it what to do, said Bod. Jack hefted the flint knife in his hand.
Beautiful,
he said to himself.
And then, of course, it's been waiting for me. And yes, obviously, I am its new master.
The sleer encircled the interior of the chamber.
Master?
It said, like a dog who had waited patiently for too long. It said,
Master,
again, as if testing the word to see how it tasted. And it tasted good, so it said it one more time, with a sigh of delight and of longing.
Master.
Jack looked down at Bod.
13 years ago I missed you, and now we are reunited. The end of one order, the beginning of another. Goodbye, boy.
With one hand, he lowered the knife to the boy's throat. The other hand held the goblet. Bod, said Bod. Not boy. Bod. He raised his voice. Sleer, he said. What will you do with your new master? The Sleer sighed.
We will protect him until the end of time. The Sleer will hold him in its coils forever and never let him endure the dangers of the world.
Then protect him, said Bod. Now.
I am your master. You will obey me, said the man Jack.
The Sleer has waited so long,
said the triple voice of the Sleer triumphantly.
So long a time.
It began to loop its huge, lazy coils around the man Jack. The man Jack dropped the goblet. Now he had a knife in each hand, a flint knife and a knife with a black bone handle, and he said,
Get back! Keep away from me! Don't get any closer!
He slashed out with the knife as the Sleer twined about him, and in a huge, crushing movement, engulfed the man Jack in its coils. Bod ran over to Scarlet and helped her up.
I want to see what's happening. I want to see.
She pulled out her LED light and turned it on. What Scarlet saw was not what Bod saw. She did not see the Sleer, and that was a mercy. She saw the man Jack, though. She saw the fear on his face, which made him look like Mr. Frost had once looked. In his terror, he was once more the nice man who had driven her home. He was floating in the air, 5, then 10 feet above the ground, slashing wildly at the air with 2 knives, trying to stab something she could not see in a display that was obviously having no effect. Mr. Frost, the man Jack, whoever he was forced away from them, pulled back until he was spread-eagled, arms and legs wide and flailing against the side of the chamber wall. It seemed to Scarlet that Mr. Frost was being forced through the wall, pulled into the rock, was being swallowed up by it. Now there was nothing visible but a face. He was shouting, wildly, desperately shouting at Bod to call the thing off, to save him, please, please. And then the man's face was pulled through the wall, and the voice was silenced. Bod walked back to the altar stone. He picked up the stone knife and the goblet and the brooch from the ground, and he replaced them where they belonged. He left the black metal knife where it fell. Scarlet said,
I thought you said the Sleer couldn't hurt people. I thought all it could do was frighten us.
Yes, said Bod, but it wanted a master to protect. It told me so. Scarlet said,
You mean ye knew? Ye knew that would happen.
Yes, I hoped it would. He helped her up the steps and out into the chaos of the Frobisher Mausoleum. I'll need to clean this all up, said Bod casually. Scarlet tried not to look at the things on the floor. They stepped out into the graveyard. Scarlet said, dully, once more,
You knew that would happen.
This time Bod said nothing. She looked at him as if unsure of what she was looking at.
So you knew that the Sleer would take him. Was that why you hid me down there? Was it? What was I then? Bait?
Bod said, It wasn't like that. Then he said, We're still alive, aren't we? And he won't trouble us any longer. Scarlet could feel the anger and the rage welling up inside her. The fear had gone, and now all she was left with was the need to lash out, to shout. She fought the urge.
And what about those other men? Did you kill them too?
I didn't kill anyone.
Then where are they?
One's at the bottom of a deep grave with a broken ankle. The other three are... well, they're a long way away.
You didn't kill them?
Of course not, said Bod. This is my home. Why would I want them hanging around here for the rest of time?
Then, look, it's okay. I dealt with them.
Scarlet took a step away from him. She said,
you aren't a person.
People don't behave like you. You're as bad as he was. You're a monster. Bod felt the blood drain from his face. After everything he had been through that night, after everything that had happened, this was somehow the hardest thing to take.
No, he said. It wasn't like that.
Scarlet began to back away from Bod. She took one step, two steps, and was about to flee, to turn and run madly, desperately away through the moonlit graveyard, when a tall man in a black velvet put a hand on her arm and said,
I am afraid you do Bod an injustice, but you will undoubtedly be happier if you remember none of this. So let us walk together, you and I, and discuss what has happened to you over the last few days, and what it might be wise for you to remember, and what it might be better for you to forget.
Bod said, Silas, you can't. You can't make her forget me.
It will be safest this way, said Silas simply. For her, if not for all of us.
Don't I get any say in this? Asked Scarlet.
Silas said nothing. Bod took a step towards Scarlet and said, Look, it's over. I know it was hard, but we did it. You and me. We beat them. Her head shook gently, as if she were denying everything she saw, everything she was experiencing. She looked up at Silas and said only,
I want to go home. Please?
Silas nodded. He walked with the girl down the path that would eventually lead them both out of the graveyard. Bod stared at Scarlet as she walked away, hoping that she would turn and look back, that she would smile or just look at him without fear in her eyes. But Scarlet did not turn. She simply walked away. Bod went back into the mausoleum. He had to do something, so he began to pick up the fallen coffins, to remove the debris, and to replace the tangle of tumbled bones into the coffins. Disappointed to discover that none of the many Frobishers and Pettifers gathered around to watch, some seemed to be quite certain whose bones belonged in which container. A man brought Scarlet home. Later, Scarlet's mother could not remember quite what he had told her, although disappointingly she had learned that that nice Jay Frost had been unavoidably forced to leave town. The man talked with them in the kitchen about their lives and their dreams, and by the end of the conversation, Scarlet's mother had somehow decided that they would be returning to Glasgow. Scarlet would be happy to be near her father and to see her old friends again. Silas left the girl and her mother talking in the kitchen, discussing the challenges of moving back to Scotland, with Nuna promising to buy Scarlet a phone of her own. They barely remembered that Silas had ever been there, which was the way he liked it. Silas returned to the graveyard and found Bod sitting in the amphitheater by the obelisk, his face set.
How is she?
I took her memories, said Silas. They will return to Glasgow. She has friends there.
How could you make her forget me?
Silas said.
People want to forget the impossible. It makes their world safer.
Bod said,
I liked her.
I'm sorry.
Bod tried to smile, but he could not find a smile inside himself.
The men, they spoke about trouble they were having in Krakow and Melbourne and Vancouver. That was you, wasn't it?
I was not alone, said Silas.
Miss Lupescu, said Bod,
then seeing the expression on his guardian's face.
Is she all right?
Silas shook his head, and for a moment his face was terrible for Bod to behold.
She fought bravely. She fought for you, Bod.
Bod said, The Sleer has the man Jack. Three of the others went through the ghoul gate. There's one injured but still alive at the bottom of the Carstairs grave. Silas said,
"He is the last of the Jacks. I will need to talk to him then before sunrise."
The wind that blew across the graveyard was cold, but neither the man nor the boy seemed to feel it. Bod said, "She was scared of me."
"Yes."
"But why? I saved her life. I'm not a bad person, and I'm just like her. I'm alive, too." Then he said, "How did Miss Lupescu fall?"
"Bravely," said Silas. "In battle, protecting others."
Bod's eyes were dark. "You could have brought her back here, buried her here. Then I could have talked to her." Silas said,
"That was not an option."
Bod felt his eyes stinging. He said, "She used to call me Nimeni. No one will ever call me that again."
Silas said, "Shall we go and get food for you?"
"We? You want me to come with you? Out of the graveyard?" Silas said,
"No one is trying to kill you. Not right now. There are things they are not going to be doing, not any longer. So yes, what would you like to eat?"
Bod thought about saying that he wasn't hungry, but that simply was not true. He felt a little sick and a little lightheaded, and he was starving. "Pizza?" he suggested. They walked through the graveyard, down to the gates. As Bod walked, he saw the inhabitants of the graveyard, but they let the boy and his guardian pass among them without a word. They only watched. Bod tried to thank them for their help, to call out his gratitude, but the dead said nothing. The lights of the pizza restaurant were bright, brighter than Bod was comfortable with. He and Silas sat near the back, and Silas showed him how to use a menu, how to order food. Silas ordered a glass of water and a small salad for himself, which he pushed around the bowl with his fork but never actually put to his lips. Bod ate his pizza with his fingers and enthusiasm. He did not ask questions. Silas would talk in his own time, or he would not. Silas said,
"We had known of them, of the Jacks, for a long, long time. But we knew of them only from the results of their activities. We suspected there was an organization behind it, but they hid too well. And then they came after you and they killed your family. And slowly, I was able to follow their trail."
"Is we you and Miss Lupescu?" asked Bod.
"Us and others like us."
"The Honor Guard," said Bod.
"How did you hear about?" said Silas.
Then,
"No matter. Little pitchers have big ears, as they say. Yes, the Honor Guard."
Silas picked up his glass of water. He put the water glass to his lips, moistened them, then put it back down on the polished black tabletop. The surface of the tabletop was almost mirrored, and had anyone cared to look, they might have observed that the tall man had no reflection. Bod said, "So, now you're done with all this. Are you going to stay?"
"I gave my word," said Silas. "I am here until you are grown."
"I'm grown," said Bod.
"No," said Silas. "Almost. Not yet."
He put a 10-pound note on the down on the tabletop. "That girl," said Bod, "Scarlet. Why was she so scared of me, Silas?" But Silas said nothing, and the question hung in the air as the man and the youth walked out of the bright pizza restaurant into the waiting darkness, and soon enough, they were swallowed by the night. Chapter 8. Leavings and Partings. Sometimes he could no longer see the dead. It had been a month or two previously, in April or in May. At first it had only happened occasionally, but now it seemed to be happening more and more. The world was changing. Bod wandered over to the northwestern part of the graveyard, to the tangle of ivy that hung from a yew tree and half blocked the far exit from the Egyptian walk. He saw a red fox and a large black cat, with a white collar and paws, who sat conversing together in the middle of the path. At Bod's approach, they looked up, startled, then fled into the undergrowth, as if they had been caught conspiring. Odd, he thought. He had known that fox since it had been a cub, and the cat had prowled through the graveyard for as long as Bod could remember. They knew him. If they were feeling friendly, they even let him pet them. Bod started to slip through the ivy, but he found his way blocked. He bent down, pushed the ivy out of the way, and squeezed through. He went down the path carefully, avoiding the ruts and holes until he reached the impressive stone that marked the final resting place of Alonso Thomas Garcia Jones. 1837-1905. Traveler, lay down thy staff. Bod had been coming here every few days for several months. Alonso Jones had been all over the world, and he took great pleasure in telling Bod stories of his travels. He would begin by saying, "Nothing interesting has ever happened to me." Then he would add gloomily, "And I have told you all my tales." And then his eyes would flash, and he would remark, "Except, did I ever tell you about..." And whatever the next words were, "The time I had to escape from Moscow," or "The time I lost an Alaskan gold mine worth a fortune," or "The cattle stampede on the Pampas," Bod would always shake his head and look expectant, and soon enough his head would be swimming with tales of derring do and high adventure, tales of beautiful maidens kissed, of evildoers shot with pistols or fought with swords, of bags of gold, of diamonds as big as the tip of your thumb, of lost cities and of vast mountains, of steam trains and clipper ships, of pampas, oceans, deserts, tundra. Bod walked over to the pointed stone, tall, carved with upside-down torches, and he waited but saw no one. He called Alonso Jones, even knocked on the side of the stone, but there was no response. Bod leaned down to push his head into the grave and call his friend, but instead of his head slipping through the solid matter like a shadow passing through a deeper shadow, his head met the ground with a hard and painful thump. He called again, but saw nothing and no one, and carefully he made his way out of the tangle of greenery and of gray stones and back to the path. Three magpies, perched in a hawthorn tree, took wing as he passed them. He did not see another soul until he reached the graveyard's southwestern slope, where the familiar shape of Mother Slaughter, tiny in her high bonnet and her cloak, could be seen, walking between the gravestones, head bent, looking at wildflowers.
"Here, boy," she called. "There's natural ashams growing wild over here. Why don't you pick some for me and put them over by my stone?"
So Bod picked the red and yellow nasturtiums, and he carried them over to Mother Slaughter's headstone, so cracked and worn and weathered that all it said now was "Laugh," which had puzzled the local historians for over 100 years. He put down the flowers in front of the stone respectfully. Mother Slaughter smiled at him.
"You're a good lad. I don't know what we'll do without you."
"Thank you," said Bod. "Then, where is everyone? You're the first person I've seen today." Mother Slaughter peered at him sharply.
"What did you do to your forehead?"
she asked. "I bumped it on Mr. Jones's grave. It was solid. I..." But Mother Slaughter was pursing her lips and tilting her head. Bright old eyes scrutinized Bod from beneath her bonnet.
"I called you boy, didn't I? But time passes in the blink of an eye, and it's a young man you are now, isn't it? How old are you?"
"About 15, I think. Though I still feel the same as I always did," Bod said. But Mother Slaughter interrupted.
"And I feels like I done when I was a tiny slip of a thing making daisy chains in the old pasture. You're always you, and that don't change. And you're always changing, and there's nothing you can do about it."
She sat down on her broken stone and said,
"I remember you the night you came here, boy. I says, 'We can't let the little fellow leave.' And your mother agrees, and all of them starts arguing and whatnot until the lady on the gray rides up. 'People of the graveyard,' she says, 'listen to Mother Slaughter. Have you not got any charity in your bones?' And then all of them agreed with me."
She trailed off, shook her little head.
"There's not much happens here to make one day unlike the next.
The seasons change, the ivy grows, stones fall over, but you coming here, well, I'm glad you did, that's all.
She stood up and pulled a grubby piece of linen from her sleeve, spat on it, and reached up as high as she could and scrubbed the blood from Bod's forehead.
There, that ought to make you look presentable, she said severely. Seeing as I don't know when next I'll see you anyway, keep safe.
Feeling discomfited in a way he could not remember having felt before, Bod made his way back to the Owens' tomb and was pleased to see both his parents waiting for him beside it. As he got closer, his pleasure turned to concern. Why did Mr. and Mrs. Owens stand like that, arranged on each side of the tomb like characters from a stained glass window? He could not read their faces. His father took a step forward and said,
"Evening, Bod. I trust you are keeping well."
"Tolerably well," said Bod, which was what Mr. Owens always said to his friends when they asked him the same question. Mr. Owens said,
"Mistress Owens and I spent our lives wishing that we had a child. I do not believe that we could have ever had a better young man than you, Bod."
He looked up at his son with pride. Bod said, "Well, yes, thank you, but..." He turned to his mother, certain he could get her to tell him what was happening, but she was no longer there. "Where did she go?" "Oh, yes," Mr. Owens seemed ill at ease.
"Ah, you know, Betsy, there's things, times, when, well, you don't know what to say, you know?"
"No," said Bod.
"I expect Silas is waiting for you," said his father, and then he was gone.
It was past midnight. Bod began to walk towards the old chapel. A tree that grew out of the gutter spire had fallen in the last storm, taking a handful of the old slate-black roof tiles with it. Bod waited on the gray wooden bench, but there was no sign of Silas. The wind gusted. It was late on a summer's night, when the twilight lasts forever, and it was warm, but still, Bod felt goose pimples rising on his arms. A voice by his ear said,
"Say you'll miss me, you lumpkin."
"Liza," said Bod. He had not seen or heard from the witch girl for over a year, not since the night of the Jacks of All Trades. "Where have you been?"
"Watching," she said. "Does a lady have to tell everything she does?"
"Watching me?" asked Bod. Liza's voice, close to his ear, said,
"Truly, life is wasted on the living. Nobody, Owens. For one of us is too foolish to live, and it is not I. Say you will miss me."
"Where are you going?" asked Bod. Then, "Of course I will miss you. Wherever you go..."
"Too stupid,"
whispered Liza Hemstock's voice, and he could feel the touch of her hand on his hand.
"Too stupid to live."
The touch of her hand of her lips against his cheek, against the corner of his lips. She kissed him gently, and he was too perplexed, too utterly wrong-footed to know what to do. Her voice said,
"I will miss you, too. Always."
A breath of wind ruffled his hair, and it was not the touch of her hand. Then he was, he knew, alone on the bench. He got up. Bod walked over to the chapel door, lifted the stone beside the porch, and pulled out the spare key left there by a long-dead sexton. He unlocked the big wooden door without even testing to see if he could slip through it. It creaked open, protesting. The inside of the chapel was dark, and Bod found himself squinting as he tried to see. "Come in, Bod." It was Silas's voice.
"I can't see anything," said Bod. "It's too dark."
"Already?" said Silas.
He sighed. Bod heard a velvet rustle, then a match was struck and it flamed, and was used to light two huge candles that sat on great carved wooden candlesticks at the back of the room. In the candlelight, Bod could see his guardian standing beside a large leather chest of the kind they call a steamer trunk, big enough inside that a tall man could have curled up and slept inside it. Beside it was Silas's black leather bag, which Bod had seen before on a handful of occasions, but which he still found impressive. The steamer trunk was lined with whiteness. Bod put a hand into the empty trunk, touched the silk lining, touched dried earth.
"Is this where you sleep?" he asked.
"When I am far from my house, yes," said Silas.
Bod was taken aback. Silas had been here as long as he could remember and before. Isn't this your home? Silas shook his head.
My house is a long, long way from here, said Silas. That is, if it is still habitable. There have been problems in my native land, and I am far from certain what I will find on my return.
You're going back? Asked Bod. Things that had been immutable were changing. You're really leaving, but you're my guardian.
I was your guardian, but you are old enough to guard yourself. I have other things to protect.
Silas closed the lid of the brown leather trunk and began to do up the straps and the buckles. Can't I stay here, in the graveyard?
You must not, said Silas, more gently than Bod could remember him ever saying anything. All the people here have had their lives, Bod, even if they were short ones. Now it's your turn. You need to live.
Can I come with you? Silas shook his head. Will I see you again?
Perhaps. There was kindness in Silas's voice, and something more. And whether you see me or not, I have no doubt that I will see you.
He put the leather trunk against the wall, walked over to the door in the far corner.
Follow me.
Bod walked behind Silas, followed him down the small spiral staircase to the crypt.
I took the liberty of packing a case for you, Silas explained as they reached the bottom.
On top of the box of mildewed hymn books was a small leather suitcase, a miniature twin Silas's own.
Your possessions are all in there, said Silas.
Bod said, Tell me about the honor guard, Silas. You're in it. Miss Lupescu was. Who else? Are there a lot of you? What do you do?
We don't do enough, said Silas. And mostly we guard the borderlands. We protect the borders of things.
What kind of borders? Silas said nothing. You mean like stopping the man Jack and his people? Silas said.
We do what we have to.
He sounded weary. But you did the right thing. I mean, stopping the Jacks. They were terrible. They were monsters.
Silas took a step closer to Bod, which made the youth tilt back his head to look up at the tall man's pale face. Silas said, I have not always done the right things. When I was younger, I did worse things than Jack, worse than any of them. I was the monster then, Bod, and worse than any monster.
It did not even cross Bod's mind to wonder if his guardian was lying or joking. He knew that he was being told the truth. He said, But you aren't that any longer, are you? Silas said,
People can change,
and then fell silent. Bod wondered if his guardian, if Silas, was remembering. Then,
It was an honor to be your guardian, young man.
His hand vanished inside his cloak, reappeared holding a battered old wallet.
This is for you. Take it.
Bod took the wallet, but did not open it.
It contains money, enough to give you a start in the world, but nothing more.
Bod said, I went to see Alonzo Jones today, but he wasn't there, or if he was, I couldn't see him. I wanted him to tell me about distant places he'd visit. He'd visited islands and porpoises and glaciers and mountains, places where people dress and eat in the strangest ways. Bod hesitated. Then, those places, they're still there. I mean, there's a whole world out there. Can I see it? Can I go there?
Silas nodded. There is a whole world out there, yes. You have a passport in the inner pocket of your suitcase. It was made out in the name of Nobody Owens, and it was not easy to obtain.
Bod said, If I change my mind, can I come back here? And then he answered his own question. If I come back, it will be a place, but it won't be home any longer. Silas said,
Would you like me to walk you to the front gate?
Bod shook his head. Best if I do it on my own. Silas, if you're ever in trouble, call me. I'll come and I'll help.
Silas said, I
do not get into trouble. No, I don't suppose you do. But still. It was dark in the crypt, and it smelled of mildew and damp and old stones, and it seemed, at the first time, very small. Bod said, I want to see life. I want to hold it in my hands. I want to leave a footprint on the sand of a desert island. I want to play football with people. I want... He said, and then he paused and thought, I want everything.
Good, said Silas.
Then he put up his hands as if he were brushing away the hair from his eyes, a most uncharacteristic gesture. He said,
If it ever transpires that I am in trouble, I shall indeed send for you.
Even though you don't get into trouble?
As you say.
There was something at the edge of Silas's lips that might have been a smile and might have been regret and might just have been a trick of the shadows. Goodbye then, Silas. Bod held out his hand, as he had when he was a small boy, and Silas took it in a cold hand the color of the old ivory and shook it gravely.
Goodbye, Nobody Owens.
Bod picked up the little suitcase. He opened the door to let himself out of the crypt, walked back up the old gentle slope to the path without looking back. It was well after the gates were locked. He wondered as he reached them if the gates would still let him walk through them, or if he would have to go back into the chapel to get a key, but when he got to the entrance, he found the small pedestrian gate was unlocked and wide open, as if it were waiting for him, as if the graveyard itself were bidding him goodbye. One pale, plump figure waited in front of the open gate, and she smiled up at him as he came towards her, and there were tears in her eyes in the moonlight. "Hello, Mother," said Bod. Mistress Owens rubbed her eyes with a knuckle, then dabbed at them with her apron, and she shook her head.
"Do you know what you're going to do now?"
she asked.
"See the world," said Bod. "Get into trouble. Get out of trouble again. Visit jungles and volcanoes and deserts and islands. And people. I want to meet an awful lot of people."
Mistress Owens made no immediate reply. She stared up at him. Then she began to sing a song that Bod remembered, a song she used to sing him when he was a tiny thing, a song that she had used to lull him to sleep when he was small.
Sleep, my little babby, oh, sleep until you waken. When you wake, you'll see the world, if I'm not mistaken.
You're not, whispered Bod, and I shall.
Kiss a lover, dance a measure, find your name and buried treasure.
Then the last lines of the song came back to Mistress Owens, and she sang them to her son.
Face your life, its pain, its pleasure, leave no path untaken.
Leave no path untaken, repeated Bod. A difficult challenge, but I can try my best. He tried to put his arms around his mother then, as he had when he was a child, although he might as well have been trying to hold mist, for he was all alone on the path. He took a step forward, through the gate that took him out of the graveyard. He thought a voice said,
I am so proud of you, my son.
But he might, perhaps, have imagined it. The midsummer sky was already beginning to lighten in the east, and that was the way Bod began to walk, down the hill, towards the living people, and the city, and the dawn. There was a passport in his bag, money in his pocket. There was a smile dancing on his lips, although it was a wary smile, for the world is a bigger place than a little graveyard on a hill, and there would be dangers in it, and mysteries, new friends to make, old friends to rediscover, mistakes to be made, and many paths to be walked before he would, finally, return to the graveyard or ride with the lady on the broad back of her great gray stallion. But between now and then there was life, and Bod walked into it with his eyes and heart wide open. And that is the end of The Graveyard Book. Neil Gaiman in the acknowledgement includes a little poem for the conclusion. I said, she's gone, but I'm alive. I'm alive. I'm coming in the graveyard to sing you to sleep now. Tori Amos, Graveyard. Neil Gaiman received the Newbery Medal for this story. Yes, he received the Newbery Medal for the Graveyard Book, and it's not hard to see why. And we're running a little over because we started a little late today, so I'm not going to say too much else. I'm just going to allow my music to lead us out, but I'll say one last thing. I very greatly enjoy this story. It's, for those who are paying attention and who remember from back when I said, it's the Jungle Book in a graveyard, and that's just such a great idea. I loved the Jungle Book growing up, and Neil Gaiman's a brilliant author. We will see you next week, when I will have picked out the next long work for us to work our way through. But until then, this has been Friday Night Frights. As always, I've been your host, Peter Yakovetsky, and everyone have a wonderful evening and a wonderful weekend.